Hello, myself Dr. Anand Kulkarni, Secretary Ayurved Proctology Association. I welcome all delegates and our speaker, Dr. Rajesh Sainani sir and Dr. Varsha Deshpande ma'am. APA, that is Ayurved Proctology Association, was established in 2017. Dr. Mahesh Sanghvi sir is founder president of APA. Aim of APA is to propagate awareness and knowledge about anorectal surgery throughout the country, and to train students and practitioners through teaching, and to bring all together qualified anorectal practitioners under one roof with integrated approach. Till now, APA has conducted two national conference, one in Malvern, Update Proctology 2017, and other in Ghat Prabha, that is Update Proctology 2019, successfully. Today, Dr. Rajesh Sainani is our speaker. His topic is approach to chronic constipation, and Dr. Rajesh Sainani is MBBS, MD, DNB, gastro, and fellow in Royal Fellowship. He has done his fellowship in Royal Melbourne Hospital, Australia. He is gastroenterologist at Jaslok Hospital, Mumbai, and his special interest is in constipation, reflux, manometry, and motility disorder.
Good afternoon, friends. I'll be talking on approach to constipation, and we have this very familiar picture on the screen of this gentleman in today's time sitting on the pot longer than required with his lota down there, and of course because he's more busy looking at his SMSs and WhatsApp and reading the newspaper. So this is a typical scene happening all over the country or maybe all over the world. But look at this picture carefully and think what may be the problem in this picture. Because through my talk, I will discuss more about this position or this posture. So how do we approach a case of chronic constipation? First is we take a good history, a good physical examination, basic blood investigations are done. And then usually patients would either have self-medicated them with fiber, or they would have seen their family physician for which they would have taken some laxative. And only if there is inadequate response or they are not satisfied or they continue to have a problem, that's when they get referred to us gastroenterologists. So how do we define constipation? For everybody, the definition is different. I'll come to the medical definition later, but let's just look at the picture. Because from the picture, you can show it to an educated person and a non-educated person. And everybody can look at a picture and tell them how their stool is. Because many times I face that in the clinic, that you ask the patient, how is your stool? And the husband or the wife or the mother of a grown-up child will answer. I always wonder, how is it that other family members are looking at the stool of the patient? So usually, if you show a picture, the patient should be able to tell you well. And the type 4 is usually what is considered like a sausage is considered as normal stool. If you have type 1, 2 or 3, then you have more the constipation type. And if you have soft blobs and fluffy pieces or liquid watery stools, then you have a diarrhea predominant kind of a stool. So this is called the Bristol stool scale chart. And this is commonly used to tell the patient what type of stool they have. When you come to the criteria, by definition, for defining chronic or functional constipation, there is the Rome 4 criteria, which says that at least two or more of the following should be present. Patient is straining. He has lumpy or hard stools. He has a sense of incomplete evacuation, or a sense of anorectal blockage, or he uses any manual maneuvers to facilitate the passage of the stool. And he has less than 3 bowel motions per week. So if any 2 or more of these symptoms are present, then you can say that your patient suffers from functional constipation. The American Gastroenterology Association defines constipation as normal transit, that is the speed of passage of stool through the colon is normal. A slow transit, where the speed of passage of stool is slow, or a defecatory disorder, that is, the transit time is normal, but the patient is not able to evacuate the stool from the rectum outside. It's very important that we must differentiate constipation from irritable bowel syndrome predominant constipation. The difference is that in irritable bowel syndrome patients, they have associated abdominal pain, which is related to defecation, and it is associated with a change in frequency or form of stool. We must rule out any systemic diseases which may be contributing to the constipation. So, does the patient have a colon cancer? Is there a stricture? Is there any metabolic condition like diabetes mellitus, hypothyroidism, heavy metal poisoning? Or are there any neurological disorders like Parkinson's or any other cognitive impairment? We must take a detailed history to find out which drugs the patient is taking, because there's a whole long list of drugs. The antiemetics, ondansetron, the painkillers, the opioid analgesics, many antihypertensive drugs like the calcium channel blockers are antidepressants, antipsychotic, anti-Parkinson's drugs. All of them cause constipation. So a good drug history to find out which drugs the patient may be taking, which may be contributing to the constipation, is important. In who do we do tests? Anybody who has what we call red flag signs. Red flag signs means if you are age more than 50 and new onset constipation, that's a red flag sign. Do you have anemia, especially iron deficiency anemia? Is there 10% weight loss in the last 3 months? Any blood in the stool? Does the symptoms wake you up in the night and want you to go to the toilet? If there is family history of colon cancer or inflammatory bowel disease, or on examination you find an enlarged liver or spleen or ascites or a mass, all these things are red flag signs, and anybody with red flag signs needs investigation and should not be sent away with only a laxative prescription. A per rectal examination to examine whether the rectum is empty, whether there is impacted stool, whether the patient is able to expel your palpating finger to look for defecatory disorders, are all essential and should be part of your regular physical examination. Everyone should not have a colonoscopy unless they have any of the previously mentioned alarm symptoms. Rectal examination, after you look for any blood or any other painful fissure or any other cause which may be contributing to the constipation, you tell the patient to try to push your finger out. In a normal person, the anal sphincter relaxes around the finger and patient is able to expel the finger. But in people with pelvic floor dysfunction, where they cannot relax the sphincter, they paradoxically contract it, and this causes pelvic floor obstruction, which impairs their ability to pass stools. What is the common treatment that we follow or that we advise? There is lifestyle and there is drugs. Most patients will take either a fiber or osmotic laxative. And we have to understand that whether the patient has slow transit constipation or normal transit constipation, long-term use of laxatives is the mainstay of treatment. We ask them for a dietary modification, especially if they are not taking an adequate diet. So if somebody is already taking adequate diet or dietary fiber, then advising extra fiber is of no consequence. If people are not taking adequate water, then you can recommend them to drink more water. And certain fruits like prunes, dried plums, have been tried against psyllium, that is isabgol. And it has been found that these fructose-rich fruits, when taken between 7 to 10 pieces per day, have been found to improve bowel symptoms. And they may be as or even more effective than isabgol. Many high-fiber fruits are present, which are commonly recommended to patients if they are not taking adequate fiber intake. You should find out whether they have a sedentary lifestyle, telling them that 30 to 60 minutes of exercise every day helps in improving stool consistency. Drugs. There's a whole list of drugs, whether you're using fiber, whether you're using osmotic laxatives like lactulose or polyethylene glycol, or stimulant laxatives like picosulfate, bisacodyl or senna, saline laxatives like milk of magnesia, or intermittent enemas, or other specific drugs like lubiprostone and prucalopride, which affect colonic motility or increase secretion into the colon. The last three, linaclotide, plecanatide, and elobexipac, are currently not available in India, but are licensed for use in the US. So any drug that you are comfortable with, that you can choose to start for the patient. You have to start one. If the patient doesn't respond, increase the dose or reach the maximum dose. If they still don't respond, add another laxative or switch to another laxative. And you need to give a combination of sometimes fiber with osmotic laxatives or osmotic laxatives with stimulant laxatives to achieve the end result to help them with their constipation. I also advise them about the posture. And that's why I was asking you to look at the first slide very well. What was wrong? People are reading the newspaper, spending time on their mobile, and that is distracting them from the aim with which they have gone to the toilet. So studies have shown that if you are squatting, that is our Indian style toilet, then you need less time and you need less pressure, less expulsive effort is required in an Indian style toilet as compared to a commode type toilet. And that is where the importance of the pelvic floor comes. You can see over here that when a person is told to bear down or strain, the anorectal angle increases. On the left side, we have what is at rest. That's the anorectal angle you can see. And when the patient strains, the anorectal angle should open. But this is in a normal person. There are some people who, when they strain, they do not open the anorectal angle, but they actually reduce it, and this worsens their constipation. So the correct posture on a Western commode, which because now more and more people are using this type of commode, is that your knee should be at a higher level than your hip joint. So if your commode is high and your height is short, you may need a small stool of 4 to 6 inches to help raise this. You must keep your back straight, your hands on your legs, and when you strain or push, your stomach should come out and not go in. That's how you strain correctly while passing stool. That's the correct posture. So when we have a patient who has not responded to the therapeutic trial of laxatives and after lifestyle changes, we still have to investigate further. Then we do something called as an anorectal manometry with a balloon expulsion test. What is it now? Anorectal manometry is a pressure study of the rectum and the anal canal along with a balloon, which the patient is told to push out as if attempting to pass stool. If the anal manometry is normal, then we say the patient does not have a defecatory disorder, and we must do a transit time to see whether the patient has slow transit constipation or not. But if the anal manometry is abnormal, that is, he is not able to relax his external sphincter while he's pushing down, then he needs further therapy. This is how a manometry reading looks like. This is the catheter with a balloon, and this balloon deflated is kept inside the rectum. And pressures are measured, and patient is told to expel a 50 cc balloon. In a patient with constipation who is not responding to laxatives, the common cause is that they are not able to relax the anal sphincter. This horizontal pink thing which is going is your anal sphincter, and vertically what is coming from the top is the rectal propulsion forces. When the patient is trying to push down here, you can see that it is becoming black. So what does black mean? Look here on the right side. If pink, which is 50, is becoming 100, that means the pressures are rising. That is paradoxical contraction of the anal sphincter. So in a normal person, when a person bears down, the anal sphincter should relax and open. But in some of them, it closes, and this is what causes constipation, and they have a sense of incomplete evacuation. Sometimes they digitally use their fingers to remove the hard stool. Sometimes they use the water jet to give themselves an enema. And this is called pelvic floor dysfunction or dyssynergic dysfunction. So what is the treatment for this? It is called biofeedback. Biofeedback is where we train the patient on the machine by visual, auditory, and verbal means. A simple task like how to relax their anal sphincter, and are taught how to evacuate the rectum. So some people will laugh, ki, what is there in doing this? I am doing this since I am born. But please understand that passing stool is a learned reflex. When you were born, you didn't know how to evacuate. You did potty all the time. And when you were about 2 years old, your parents toilet trained you. So anything that is learned or taught can be forgotten, or a wrong habit can be developed because of which you are not relaxing your anal sphincter. So we teach them diaphragmatic breathing exercises. We teach them exercises how to relax the anal sphincter, how to do a recto-anal coordination. We do stimulation of defecation with a balloon. If they have what is called a mega rectum, that is, they store a lot of stool and they don't get a sensation easily, we do a sensory training. And all this is called biofeedback. Patients need 8 to 10 sessions of about 20 minutes each once a week. And then they practice these exercises at home so that they can achieve satisfactory defecation. There are multiple studies and shows that biofeedback training for constipation is an effective modality of therapy. As I said earlier, if the anal manometry is normal, then you need to see, does the patient have a slow transit or a delayed transit? Here, multiple capsules are given and x-rays are taken at day 1, day 2, and at day 5 to see the amount of residual markers remaining in the colon. If you have excess of 20% of markers, these radiopaque markers remaining in the colon, then you can say that the patient has a slow transit. If the markers are distributed along the length of the colon, then that is a slow transit of the large bowel. If they remain in the pelvis, then you say that it's probably secondary to the defecatory disorder, because of which they cannot expel the colonic markers. So in a person with slow transit constipation, we usually give laxatives. We give a combination of polyethylene glycol along with a stimulant laxative like bisacodyl. And if it improves, great. But if it does not improve, then we use the newer pharmacological agents which improve colonic motility like prucalopride. But say it does not improve. Say everything you have done to improve colonic motility, but you're not getting the desired result. Then you must think, is there a problem at the upper end? Is it that the stomach and the upper part of the GI tract, are they working properly? And if required, you may do what is called as gastric emptying study. Gastric emptying study is where you give a solid meal of roti, sabji, and dal, in which a sulfur colloid technetium is mixed. And then you look over the next 4 hours how the patient's stomach empties, at what speed, and how much residue is there. If more than 10% of the tracer is present at 4 hours, then you say that the stomach muscle is also not working, and that may be contributing to the delayed emptying. And may be contributing towards the constipation. So if the gastric emptying is slow, then you know that there is a problem at the upper end of the gastrointestinal tract, and then that needs to be treated. But if the gastric emptying is normal, then you have to decide that a person with slow transit, does he need a subtotal colectomy because of extremely slow transit? If the patient has a defecatory disorder, that is, he's not able to evacuate stools and the anal sphincter is not relaxing. As I said, we do pelvic floor training and repeat the tests. If the tests are still abnormal, then you want to do an MRI defecogram to see whether is there any anatomical obstruction to the passage of stool. And if there is a large rectocele which is retaining the stool products, then maybe surgery can be offered. So in an MR defecography, we place an ultrasonic jelly into the rectum and we ask the patient to expel it. And here you can see that there is a descent of the pelvic floor and there is a rectocele present here, which is retaining contrast, which may be contributing to the patient's symptoms. So coming to my last slide, when you have a patient of chronic constipation, a detailed history is important. A good physical examination or per rectal examination to check the anal pressure and the ability of the patient to push a palpating finger. Give a trial of laxatives. Tell them about lifestyle changes, about the correct posture of how to pass stool. But if he has any red flag signs, that is, if there are new symptoms beyond the age of 50, blood in the stool, anemia, family history of cancer, then you must do a colonoscopy and other tests to rule out any medical problem before you investigate further. Once you know that there is no worrying cancer, no obstruction, now you have to find out what type of constipation is the patient suffering for. For that, you will first do an anorectal manometry with the balloon expulsion test. If that is normal, you want to look at a colonic transit study and in a few select patients, an MRI defecography if you suspect a defecatory disorder. These tests will help you to subclassify your non-responsive constipations to whether they have normal transit, slow transit constipation, or a pelvic floor disorder, so that you can offer them appropriate therapy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh Sainani, sir. Welcome, Dr. Varsha Deshpande, ma'am. Our next speaker is Dr. Deshpande, ma'am. Rahul, please unmute, ma'am. Yes. Dr. Varsha Deshpande, ma'am, is practicing as gynecologist this 27 years, conducted more than 6,000 deliveries in her own hospital, performing routine obstetric and gynec surgeries, running Panchakarma Center exclusively for women since 5 years. Her achievements are governing body member of prestigious Rashtriya Ayurveda Vyasapeeth, New Delhi, presented many papers in national and international conferences. Her today's I request Dr. Mayan to start her today's lecture. Thank you.
At the outset, good evening, friends. At the outset, let me thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity of being here with you. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, yes, ma'am. Yes, you are audible, ma'am.
Yes, and I'm not getting my screen. Yes. So it is certainly a great honor given to me. I pay my respect to late Dr. S.I. Nagrar, who taught us surgery in my undergraduate days. I'm happy that Dr. Rajesh Gupta is here. I pay my respect to him also, and I start my lecture. My talk today is on constipation in pregnancy, pregnancy, we all know, is a special stage in a woman's life, a time of happiness, anxiety, fear, a long wait of 9 months, and then fulfillment of dreams. So it's a period of mixed emotions. Constipation. One second. Constipation is the second commonest complaint in pregnancy, first being nausea. We all know that nausea is a welcome symptom of pregnancy, but constipation is certainly not. The definition of constipation, I really do not appreciate this definition, not in our Indian pregnant women. I think this definition suits the Western people. In the West, they eat a lot of non-veg food items. They are cooked and sprinkled with a little spices. They eat it as it is or with bread, which has less fiber. Pulses, cereals, vegetables, fruits are consumed in less quantity and not daily as we Indians do. We Indians consume a lot of vegetables, fruits, cooked and even uncooked almost daily. Even the non-vegetarian Indians eat a lot of vegetables along with the non-veg food. The gravy of the non-veg item is made of a lot of onions, tomatoes, and even coconuts. The popular green spices like fresh coriander, pudina are necessarily in the non-veg food items. A salad always accompanies the non-veg foods, and we eat it with rotis, which have a lot of fiber too. So our stools are bulky due to the fiber content. If we do not pass them in 24 hours, we feel uneasy, unwell. It is the first sign of health to evacuate first thing in the early morning. Ayurveda has described a healthy person as passing stools once or twice daily and urinating 6 times daily. So our definition of constipation should be framed according to our patients. I have not seen a single pregnant woman who has not passed stools as rare as 3 times a week in my 28 years of practice. So I feel the Roman criteria suits us. The earlier speaker, Dr. Rajesh, has told us about this criteria, and I feel this criteria defines constipation better. He also taught us about the Bristol chart. Sorry. The Bristol chart, of which the two type 1 and type 2 type of stools, they fall into the type of constipation. They come in constipation. So let's come to the causes of constipation. We all know that in pregnancy, the progesterone hormone increases in the body, and this slows down the GI movement. The gut movement is slowed down so that the nutrients are absorbed and they are not thrown out through the stool. And with progesterone increasing, motilin goes down. And even the relaxin increases, and so gut motility still slows down. The physical activity of the patient is less in pregnancy. There is change in diet. She has a lot of iron supplements taking. The growing uterus also gives a little pressure on the colon, and so the gut motility slows down. But with that, water is absorbed. As the water is absorbed, the stools become harder, drier, and they are thus difficult to expel. Sometimes hypothyroidism also causes constipation, and in pregnancy we diagnose it first. Many a times it is first diagnosed at the time of pregnancy itself. The causes of constipation in Ayurveda text, let's study them. They said that eating Ruksha, Guru, Shita Ahar in excess. These Ruksha Ahar has Vayu, Mahabhut in it. And Guru Ahar has Jala and Prithvi Mahabhut in it. Shitahar, we know Stambhane Shita, it stops the activity, so it slows down the gut. Shita Virya, again, we know that it is Stambhane Shita, it stops the activity of the gut or at least slows it down. Then when we have Kashaya Katu and Tikta Rasa Ahar in excess, Kashaya Katu, Tikta all contribute to the rise of Vayu or Vatavruddhi. Or sometimes it is Ati Langhan, she eats in very small quantity. Or she's doing some crash diets. We hear people doing it for weight loss. And then the quantity of food which she takes is very less. And so the stools formed are very less. She takes less liquid intake also many a times because of nausea, because of vomiting. And that's why the stool quantity is less. Eating very fast, very slow, they all contribute to the indigestion. Eating at wrong meal times when you're not hungry, they are causes of indigestion. If she's working ladies, having a job, sitting for long hours in one position, less physical activities, they also slow down your GI tract movement. Controlling urges. We know in Ayurveda has said that there are 13 urges which are not to be controlled. Veg Vidharan, which we say. Amongst them, urine and stool urge, if it is controlled, it will give rise to constipation. Then we have some emotions of anxiety, fear, sorrow, and depression. They are all Vata Vardha, and Vata Vishyeshan, we all know, will contribute to constipation. Late to bed and late to rise. This is what the youth are doing of today. This is against the biological clock in your body, and so it causes Vata Vishyeshan. And we have to treat the constipation, because if she strains a lot, there's damage to the pudendal nerve, which impairs the function of the pelvic floor and may result in utero-vaginal prolapse later in life. And beware if the change in bowel habits remains for more than 6 weeks, or if there is associated rectal bleeding, or if she has a history of inflammatory bowel disease and family history of colorectal cancer. We come to the signs and symptoms. I don't know where the slide went. So the signs and symptoms are that she passes hard stools, she has anorexia, she has pain in abdomen, there's indigestion which leads to bloating, flatulence, hyperacidity, which causes headache. There is a feeling of incomplete evacuation. There is pain at anus also. We come to the treatment of constipation in pregnancy. We have to educate the patient. We have to tell her the change in her diet. We have to give her reassurance that all her symptoms will be treated. Then the prevalent science or the modern science advises lot of fiber to be eaten in the food, in the diet, and lot of fluids to be taken. Ayurveda doesn't feel so. I'll come in the next slide what Ayurveda has to say. Then we have to give her proper physical activities. We can tell her about exercises. So the exercises for constipation in pregnancy, we all know walking is the best exercise for pregnancy. Sweeping the floor, we all know it has been come as a tradition, but now nobody is doing it. But we go in for pregnancy exercises, classes. Climbing is also good, but without carrying any weight. She can do yoga. She can do actually what she has to do is she has to move all her joints. She can do stretching exercises. She can do all the exercises where there is no extra pressure coming on her abdomen. the butterfly manures are very useful for the pelvic floor muscles, to develop the tone of the pelvic floor muscles, and the spinal twists are also very important. So we can see the picture of the exercises. See, these are the pelvic tilts done on in lying position, and this is the pelvic tilt done in sitting position. And this is the butterfly maneuver I was talking about. So this helps strengthening the muscles of the pelvis and the thighs also. So which toilet is good? So Indian or Western? We all are blind followers of the West. We do not test anything without accepting anything which comes from the West. We should actually test everything on scientific basis, which we really don't. Indian toilet is most conducive to expelling stools easily, helping the muscles of defecation to defecate thoroughly. Pregnant women, especially urban women, are scared to squat. Pregnancy is a normal stage in a woman's life, but she is treated like a patient and thus is scared of squatting, a position helping digestion to a certain extent, but extremely useful for defecation and extremely good to develop the muscles of the thighs and the pelvis. Squatting strengthens your lower limbs. Once you use the Western toilet, you have to use it forever, as your limbs cannot squat as the age advances. So as proctologists, it is our duty to spread this scientific rationale for the use of Indian toilets. So be Indian right from the beginning of the day. Next, after the exercises, we come to the type of laxatives. The earlier speaker has told us about the laxatives. There are bulk forming laxatives, there are osmotic laxatives, stimulant laxatives, lubricant laxatives, suppositories, and enemas. And they are quite popular, but they also have few side effects. The bulk forming laxatives, if taken in excess, they cause gas, bloating, cramps in abdomen. And the osmotic laxatives, the most popular were used in pregnancy amongst the osmotic laxative is the lactulose, and it may lead to electrolyte imbalance. The stimulant laxatives, they cause passing of stools again and again for a long time, and you cannot control it many of the times. The lubricant laxatives, which are usually of the mineral oil, liquid paraffin, glycerin suppositories, their overuse may cause deficiency of fat-soluble vitamins. And so we have a battery of Ayurvedic laxatives to offer you. So we have types of Ayurvedic laxatives. See, these are Anuloman Dravya, Bhedan, Pachan. They all assist passing of stools. They all assist defecation. And proper laxatives we can call, these are Mrudu Virechan, Madhyam Virechan, and Tikshna Virechan. Amongst which we use only Mrudu Virechan and Sraunsan Dravya for the pregnant woman. So among all these, we are using only these few in the pregnant women. So if a patient of constipation in pregnancy comes to me, I take her history, I talk to her, I examine her, I determine her prakriti, I ask her about her diet, I correct it where necessary, I ask her about her activities, lifestyle, exercises, and I give her the necessary advice. On examining, we find Samatha in most of the patients. Samatha is an Ayurvedic concept. It denotes indigestion as per Ayurvedic standards. Examining it and treating it is the strength of Ayurveda. If the pregnant lady is Kapha Pradhan, we give Shunti, Musta, or Pipali. Pitta Pradhan, she gets Ushir. Vata Pradhan, she may get Shatapushpa, Gokshur, Punarnava, Badar, Parushak. Badar, Parushak have Amlar Anuras, and thus they are Agni Vardhak. Pachan and Anuloman, and so decrease the constipation and are good tonics as they are described as Santarpan Dravya. We can use Abhipattika Churna with warm water before dinner, especially in Pitta or Vata Pradhanta. As the Samatha decreases, she becomes Niram. Constipation will be relieved in many patients as they attain Niramata. Samatha is associated with Sthyanata of the Mala. That is, the Mal tends to adhere to the bowel wall. And if we give a laxative without treating the Samatha, she may pass stools but will require the laxative daily and may not defecate unless laxative is administered. And we will term it as habit forming. But if we treat the Samatha first, she will not require laxative for a very long time. Once she is Niram, or once she is in the Niram Avastha, she can follow the Garbhini Paricharya as described in the text. Ayurveda has lot many things to give her in the diet. She can start the day with milk and in which ghee is added. This will not only lubricate but oleate the entire system and her body too. Morning is rasayan kal, and both milk and ghee are nitya rasayan, that is rasayan or tonics which are to be consumed daily by everyone and especially by a pregnant woman. She can also have amal ki rasayan, that is she can eat amla, she can eat mor aula, she can eat jam of amla, that is mostly in leha form or which can be in a semi-solid form. Chyavanprash is also an amal ki rasayan in leha form, but is prescribed for geriatric patients in the text. So we do not give it to our pregnant patients. She can take black raisins and dried figs in the morning with milk, or in every meal she can consume it. Both raisins and figs are santarpan and mridu virajan. She can take fennel seeds, sauf or body shape, which we call, even before food, it helps digestion more. We have a popular supari mix which does not have the betel nut but has yashti madhu in much quantity, glyceriza glabra. We know yashti madhu is a rasayan and a mridu virechak too. Every month a specific fluid diet is advised by text to the pregnant lady. It is for the nourishment of the baby. It is in the form of manda, peya, yavagu with certain specifications. Ayurveda does not advise drinking plenty of fluids. Ayurveda advises to drink water only to quench the thirst. Atyambupan, or drinking lot of fluids, is condemned by Ayurveda. Atyambupan decreases the agni and so the digestion is not proper. Proper digestion is very important for the pregnant woman whose baby is growing. The baby's dhatus are forming, getting shape, and the dhatus are forming from the rasa dhatu of the mother, and so the digestion of the mother has to be proper. Ayurveda does not advise eating too much leafy vegetables. As discussed earlier, Indian diet has a lot of fiber in it, and so the extra consumption of leafy vegetables is not advocated. Even fruits are to be consumed only when hungry. Uncooked vegetables are also not to be consumed in excess. They can be taken in a small portion when hungry at mealtimes. Ayurveda advises nourishing, oleating medicines to the pregnant woman if she is still complaining of constipation despite the diet advised. She receives ghee treated with medicinal herbs conducive for easy defecation. We have this in the form of Yashti Madhu Siddha Ghrut or Gokshur Siddha Ghrut, Punarnava Ghrut to facilitate defecation. She can be given Drakshavaleha, a special formulation for the pregnant woman and children. Trivrut Leha or Trivrut Kalpa can also be given in a small quantity. Sukumar Ghrut has also been described for women and children. Sukumar Ghrut has Arandas Sneha in it. We all know Arandas Sneha cannot be administered to a Garbhini until the 9th month. But this Sukumar Ghrut has Arandas Sneha with Ghrita and herbs, which are Rasayan or have a tonic effect and decreasing the rukshata of the body. And if this pregnant woman comes to us with great agony, has not passed stools for a long time, has pain in abdomen, or she has fullness in abdomen, passing hard stools with difficulty, and if she is in great agony, we give her Matra Basti. We give her Matra Basti. This is an enema of oil, warm till oil or coconut oil or any Siddha Tel, that is any oil treated with herbs, given in a small quantity of 30 to 60 ml with Sainav. This small quantity will reach only the rectum and oleates the stool and the rectum. It is in small quantity, so patient has no discomfort to take it. It is a better stool softener than RHS oil, liquid paraffin or glycerin. These oils leave a ruksha effect on the bowels. And they also absorb fat-soluble vitamins and eliminate them through the stool. We all know that fat-soluble vitamins are so very important to the pregnant woman. This Matra Basti will not stimulate gut motility beyond limits. Even a small suppository sometimes motivates gut movements, which is difficult to control. But this does not happen with Matra Basti. Matra Basti will not be habit forming also. So to conclude, Matra Basti scores over all types of laxatives, can be safely and effectively used in emergency. Basti, we all know, is to be avoided in pregnancy until the 9th month. But a Matra Basti or a Sneha Basti in a small quantity can be given even for days together if it is really required. So I come to the end of my talk. I have given you an overview of what Ayurveda has to offer to constipation in pregnancy. Thanks for the opportunity given to me and thanks for the patient listening. I would certainly like to answer your queries. Thanks you once again.
Thank you, Dr. Varsha Deshpande, ma'am, for her excellent lecture on constipation in pregnancy, etiology and management. Ma'am has very well explained about the dynamics of Garbhini, what activities should be carried out by Garbhini. Now, today our moderator is Dr. Eunice Solanki, sir. Dr. Solanki, sir, is from my hometown, Parbhani, professor in R.A. Poddar College since 30 years. And he had participated as a panelist speaker in many national and international conferences. And he is a respected founder member and advisor of Ayurveda Proctology Association.
Thank you, Dr. Anand. It was an excellent session on the first day of our webinar series today. Dr. Sainani had very quickly and briefly covered all the topics, right from the definition to the complex topics of manometry and biofeedback therapy also. He had also shown us the Bristol stool chart, the definition of it. Dr. Varsha Deshpande had covered a very complex topic and very common condition happening during the course of pregnancy, that is constipation in pregnancy and how to tackle the constipation. And she beautifully covered maximum part with treatment without the medicine and how to implement the Ayurveda concept on this, which are differing from what modern thought gives it to it and what Indian civilization adopts. The granny at home used to handle the constipation in pregnancy, even in advanced pregnancy also. And these are the facts, you know, commonly practiced in our household during pregnancy period. She had covered all this topic very beautifully. And I'm very glad that on the first day, such two brilliant speakers started our webinar on constipation. I am thankful for this presentation to both of them, Dr. Sainani and Dr. Varsha Deshpande. Thank you, Anand. All right. I think we are coming to end of today's webinar and first day. As Dr. Anand had said, tomorrow we have again lined up very brilliant speakers for one is Dr. Megharaj Ingre and another one is Dr. Ashwin Porwal. They are also very brilliant speaker. I have heard them before also. So let us wait till tomorrow, and we will meet tomorrow again. Thank you, Dr. Senani, Dr. Varsha. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh Senani, sir, and Dr. Varsha Deshpande, ma'am, for the excellent lecture on constipation. Madam has very well explained about the Dainandini of Garbhini, that what activities and yoga activities should be carried out by a Garbhini, and some Ayurvedic line of treatment is very well explained by ma'am. Thank you all, and we in this way conclude tomorrow's our lecture is on constipation or bowel dysfunction, causes, signs and symptoms. Is it a life disorder, by Dr. Meghraj Ingle. And the second our speaker will be Dr. Ashwin Porwal. Learn more about manometry, biofeedback, defecography and star surgery. Thank you all. Thank you for all delegates for attending. I conclude the session. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.